Ben, you know I'm here today because my son-in-law sent me the record, and I called him back and I said, Barry, this is so good. This sound is so distinct, and the harmonies are just so beautiful. Are you sure that you have talked to your mother and to your two sisters about singing with these three ugly boys?
Well, I plead the fifth.
You have sung for years with three women. Yeah. And that's one of the greatest sounds in our field, and everybody recognizes it and understands it. However, you've kind of moved over to the Gaither side. There is something about singing with male singers, isn't there?
There really is. It's different. It's a different thing. And, you know, I love the blend that we have. You know, yeah. It's very special. And I'm grateful to have this opportunity to sit with some of my buddies and make some of the, in my opinion, some of the prettiest music. Love song music, or just life music.
Songs about real life.
Right. You know, 90% of what you do on stage happens off the stage.
Absolutely.
It's about relationship.
Yeah.
And if you have a great relationship with each other, you're going to perform great, whether that's marriage or that's in a quartet.
You've got a great, great project here, and I'm so happy for you. Only one thing on your next one, you don't need Gordon. I've learned how to play the piano myself on it, so I could help you.
But I thought you were getting more popular with your boom boom.
Brotherly love. I have always loved that song. And somehow that's made its way to this brand new record, and it really is an amazing title for what this is. Congratulations on this, guys.
Thank you. Thank you so much. You.
How long has this process been in the works?
A couple of years. I would say at least 2 years. You know, these are some of my best friends in the whole wide world. And Mike and I have sang with Jimmy, and Mike and I have sang with Bradley before this, and we blend so well, we thought, what would it be like all together? Mm-hmm. So it's, man, I'm telling you, wait till you hear this one sing bass right here.
Oh, it'll blow your mind. I've heard it. You know, I've heard him sing bass. He sings with us from time to time, yeah. Bradley. I've known all of you for a good while, some of you a little longer than others, but probably know Bradley the best. And I've heard him sing bass, you know, and he's incredible, but I never heard him in a blend like this before. Mm-hmm. So this is a pretty special thing.
Very special.
We were talking about earlier that not only is the title Brotherly Love, but it's really become a bit of a brotherhood for you.
For sure.
For you guys. Yeah,
for sure, absolutely.
I love singing with these guys. We all love singing together, but we love each other as people. You know, we truly love each other, and we support each other, and just we have a blast together, whether we're singing songs or whether we're just hanging out. Such a blessing for all of us.
I feel that we are all each other's biggest cheerleaders. You know, we spend so much time working and creating together that, you know, when it's right, you know, everybody's as excited as you are. You know, it's really special.
This is a project where literally no one stands alone. Or in this particular setting, no one sits alone.
Right.
And I love this song, Bradley, and this is one that you're singing lead on. And I love it because on your own, you are all incredible singers, songwriters, performers, musicians. But together, you're something even more. And this title and what this song's about is something much bigger than just this, but No One Stands Alone is pretty special. How did that end up being on this record?
That is a song that I've known for a long time. Anyone who's a Christian and who has Jesus in their life, it's such a comfort to know that no matter what you go through, you're never alone.
Wow.
You never are alone.
Mm-hmm.
It's very fitting. And so I was very proud to be able to sing this with these guys.
No collection like this would be complete without a Johnny Cash song.
That's right.
Oh, yeah.
And this one, which is
Bradley sang bass,
Jimmy sang tenor. Right. Oh, yeah. Or something. Is it Jimmy or is
Jimmy
it Mike?
Jimmy sang tenor.
Jimmy sang tenor. Yeah. Oh, yeah. Oh, you're up there on this one.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, you're way up there.
And it wasn't easy.
As Jimmy said before, Mike and I have the parts that don't matter.
Yeah. Yeah. That's fine. Yeah.
Mike and I have.
No, I didn't say that. You know.
I read online that on the original Johnny Cash recording that Lou and Don actually sing Me and Little Brother.
We'll join right in there.
Yeah. Did you know that?
I did not know that.
Yeah. I didn't know that.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's amazing.
I didn't know that.
And who sang the girl's part?
Was it June?
No, it wasn't June. It people think it was June, but it was actually Jan Howard.
Jan Howard.
No kidding.
Jan Howard.
Wow.
Yeah,
really?
I mean, unless Wikipedia is wrong, which is surely it's not.
It's on the internet.
It's on the internet. Yeah, the internet's true.
You know what?
Surely
the
it is.
The thing of it was, I got to sing on the 30th anniversary of the Statler Brothers. I got to sing that with John and on stage with the Statler Brothers.
Johnny Cash?
Yeah.
Mm.
Yeah.
Oh, we're done.
That was one of the treats of my whole life.
Wow.
You know, that's I didn't get to be around him a whole lot, but not too long before he died, one of the greatest things anybody ever said to me was we went to see him at his home, and we were walking out, and he stopped me because I would always sit back and kind of listen to what everybody had to say. I didn't, you know, I was just so in awe of everything. And he stopped me and put his hands on my shoulder and said, Jimmy, he said, I really regret that I didn't get to know you a lot better. He said, but I was worried about the Statler Brothers when they changed over and you came along. And he said, but when I heard Elizabeth, I knew everything was going to be all right.
Mm, isn't
that something? I really loved and respected him a lot because I know he went through a lot in his life and everything, but I know in his heart he came back to Jesus before it was all over with. And that to me meant more than anything.
All you guys are amazing harmony singers, but when you put all these great harmony singers together, that's a whole other animal. What did you think about that, Ben, you know, recording-wise?
Oh, man.
When they all came together the way that you guys have.
The first time that we got together, I got chills because the blend, to me, singing together and the vocal blend that we have, other than our relationship with each other, is the most special thing about it.
Mm-hmm. Every now and then, you sing with certain people, and there's something there that's really special, you know, and we have that.
And people will try to say, well, how can I learn how to sing harmony? I don't know if I can teach anybody. It's just something that you hear. And I was doing it before I knew what it was, you know, as a kid.
Special.
Yeah. So.
And we all really listen to each other.
Mm-hmm.
If Bradley's singing lead, we try to absolutely get into that blend with him, and it makes it so special.
Yeah.
And Jimmy, when Jimmy goes to a lead, or Ben,
it's
like we all gravitate to that voice and listen.
Well, it's easy to tell that you guys have something special because even when you're singing someone else's song that you know really well, or even a quartet song or something like Elizabeth, where you've heard an amazing harmony blend before, you've not heard this one before. It's really special. Let's talk a little bit about Elizabeth. Now, I read again on the interweb, so surely it's true.
It's all true.
Was that the first song you wrote for the Statlers?
The first song I ever wrote.
I didn't believe that was true.
Yeah,
that's true. The first song you ever wrote?
See, when I got a guitar when I was 12 years old, I didn't have any songs to listen to learn it. I was kind of making up songs, you know, just making up things. I didn't know I was writing, actually, but I never really put anything down. But then I started learning other people's songs. For so many years, I was playing clubs for 6 nights a week, 4 hours a night, doing cover music for years and years and years before the Statler Brothers hired me. I didn't have time to do any, sit down and realize that I had something to say or sing about, really. And so when they hired me, I mean, you talk about God things in your life that you can't explain. And I knew in the back of my heart and my mind, I knew that I said, man, you know, Lou was a songwriter. I said, I'm just singing tenor. I said, maybe I need to write a song. I need to do something to just say, hey, this is who I am. You know, I can bring something. And it was literally a God thing. I mean, I had a melody that just came to me that was just in my head. And it kept being there. And I said, man, that's a beautiful harmony. I said, that's just so harmony oriented, and I said, I need something to go with it, you know. And I kept hearing this name over and over again everywhere I would go. Elizabeth, and a little girl in a grocery store. Her mom was getting on her about everything. She was getting into stuff, and then on the way to Tulsa, Oklahoma, to do a concert, we watched the movie Giant with Elizabeth Taylor, the name just kept coming up. Then we get to Oklahoma, and there's a girl comes up out of the audience, grabs me by the hand, wouldn't let go, saying, I'm Elizabeth. And so I go back, I said, God, I know you're trying to tell me something. I go back to the hotel room, and I had two of those tape recorders. It was a Walkman.
Yeah.
And I sang into one in the bathroom because it has good echo there, right? You know. I had a verse and a chorus written. And so I hit the button and I sang into this one and I played it again, sang harmony into this one. And I played back and sang another harmony. I stacked the harmonies on it.
Wow.
And then I took it the next morning and I said, I wrote this last night because I asked them, I said, if I write a song, would you all record it? And Harold said, yeah, if it's good enough. And so when I hit play on it, I just knew it was a great harmony song. And when I played it, they said, oh yeah, well, that's going on our first record. And wow. It was the third single and number one song, and I won Songwriter of the Year that year for the song.
How about first that? Song.
And first song he ever wrote.
Song of the Year, and fan-voted Song of the Year in 1984. I mean those are things cool. You can only, God, you know, can put those things together. He knew the Statler Brothers needed something about that time. He knew that I needed something to kind of make a place for myself.
Mm-hmm. And he was setting you up at the time to continue with them and help them through that time. Yeah. But even more than that, setting you up for a time in the future for you to write songs for other people, for you to have your own success as an artist, and then be in here together recording Elizabeth with
all
these guys.
All these God things have brought us to this
amazing,
point right here today that I just can't even explain.
We're excited about this new project and this song in particular on it. Now, how many of you guys are from the bluegrass world? All of you? Mm-hmm. Three of you. Mm-hmm. Three of you.
Oh, Jimmy?
No, not really. Same with me. Like, I didn't really grow up in the bluegrass world. It took me a long time to get there. I think I got there through you two guys.
Wow.
Because Joey and I, I don't know when it was, maybe 2000. When did your first record come out?
2006.
So I discovered that. And that was basically bluegrass instrumentation. Mm-hmm. So it was just beautiful. Around the same time, you had a record that has Halfway Home on it. Half a Day Away.
Half a Day Away, yes.
Half a Day Away.
Half a Day Away, yes.
Oh, I wore it out, and it's the same. It was like it was bluegrass instrumentation, but it was great songs and great singing. And then I went and saw Bradley at an award show. He was up for Male Vocalist of the Year. Anyone. And it was really a great moment because Joey and I were big fans. And so we go to this award show. It's at the Grand Ole Opry. I don't have a ticket. Somebody's date didn't show up. And Joey didn't come with me, so I was by myself. I'm sitting in the back. And I'm really just there to see Bradley Walker because I heard he was coming. And he comes rolling out and he wins. And he comes up, they give him the microphone. He's like, oh, shucks, y'all, I'm just a country boy from Alabama.
That's him.
And I thought, he has no idea the gift God has given him. Yeah. No idea. And I loved him more. And from there, you know, if you started looking around, listening, you just realized he'd been singing bluegrass for a long time. Mm-hmm. You know, a guy like you who has a voice and a gift like you, in country music, sometimes they're trying to figure out what to do with you. You know, they're just not sure. Like, well, how does he travel? Does he get on? But then what happens? And I think in bluegrass, they say, why don't we just roll him up to a microphone and let him sing?
Exactly.
It's about that easy, and that's all that really needs to happen.
Well, and that's exactly what happened in the bluegrass world. And to take that a step further, I'm so thankful that Bill Gaither didn't see an obstacle when he saw a wheelchair.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Well, the gospel world's real similar. That's the same thing. Let's roll him up and let him sing.
Right.
You know, when we're all together, it's like we don't even see that wheelchair. Mm-hmm. Honest to God, we look at him. He's just like us. I mean, as far as I'm concerned, and we love him so much, but we respect his talent, but we mostly the person that he is.
It's hard.
But when you're around him for a little while, it's like, what wheelchair?
Yeah.
Really, honest to God, we know it's just
You know, I think
until he runs over your toe.
Yeah.
then you go that wheelchair.
Right.
There it is. And then the big bluegrass explosion happened. You know, in the public, the big explosion was, "Oh Brother, Where Art Thou?"
Mm-hmm. Yes, that was awesome to me. Mm-hmm. That movie just opened up bluegrass so much.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Again.
Yeah, again.
It was just like, wow, man, this is going back to the roots. Mm-hmm. I love it. It was so special.
This song, Man of Constant Sorrow, it's been around a long, long time. Mm-hmm. Ralph Stanley didn't record it till 1950, so most people hadn't heard it till then. And then, of course, When Oh Brother came out. But you guys did a great job on this
Thank
one.
Thank you.
Mike, yes.
He's one of the most talented people that I've ever known in my life since I moved to Nashville. He not only sings great, great harmony singer, but he can play anything he puts his hands on. And it is amazing. I'm not just saying that, but one of the most talented people in this town as far as I'm concerned. He really is. Coming to do this with calling it brotherly love, I mean, wherever we needed brotherly love, it sure is now.
Yeah.
We need to look at each other. And we got something to sing about. We got purpose. And having that purpose is what, you know, what drives us. And it's the reason we're here today, not just because of the music, but it's because of the purpose of the music.
I love that each of you brought in some songs. When you said, hey, we're going to have this pool of songs on a record, everybody had some different ideas. And one was this song, Only Lonely, that you brought in, right? I love that song.
Well, it's a J.D. Souther song that I sung years ago. And I had a good friend of mine last year. I told him we were putting together this project. His name was Chuck Dauphin. He wrote for Billboard magazine.
Chuck passed away, right?
And he passed away, but he called me not long before he passed away. And he said, Jimmy, he said, I really want you to record this song, Only Lonely, You're Only Lonely. And I said, it's weird you said that, Chuck, because I said, I used to do that song years ago. And he said, man, he said, I've talked with some friends of mine. We sat around and talked, man, what would you love to hear Jimmy Fortune sing this song, You're Only Lonely? And so I said, well, I'll tell you what. I told Ben about it, and he said, well, we'll do it. We'll put it on the record. And then, of course, he passed away not too long ago, last year.
Yeah.
And I never got to play it for him, you know, because he passed away before we recorded it, actually.
Well, we'll send this one out to Chuck.
Absolutely.
Mike is probably the biggest heart on the stage. And I mean, it's just, you know, you get those people in life that you get to make music with, but you also get to be friends along with it. And that's, you know, I think that's one reason that we make great music together is because we have a great relationship together. You know, I think 90% of your stage performance happens not on the stage, it happens in your relationship.
That's right.
And he's a great guy to have a relationship with.
Thank y'all. Bradley, last time I saw you, we were in Dallas.
We were in Dallas.
Right. And you were part of another group, sort of. You were part of a bigger show. We have a room for maybe 150 people here, but how many people were there for that?
Gosh.
10,000, 15,000?
20, I think it was 20,000 seat arena. Yeah.
And you were there with Eric Clapton.
Eric Clapton.
Which was crazy. Yeah. It was so neat.
Incredible.
I flew down there just to be there and watch you and be beside you as you got this opportunity. Yeah. You want to tell a little bit about this story? Not everybody's heard this story, how it came to be.
You know, it's just one of the craziest things and one of the biggest blessings. Eric had heard some of my music. He heard a song that we recorded on my Blessed album called Drifting Too Far from the Shore.
Yes, sir.
It's a great, great song. But he'd heard that on YouTube. Vince Gill and I sang that together on that album, and he just, for whatever reason, just loved that song and loved my voice, and he took it upon himself to reach out to me and invite me to come sing at his Crossroads Guitar Festival last year.
That's awesome.
A guy who doesn't even play guitar, can't even play guitar, a singer coming to Dallas, Texas, in the middle of all these rock stars, people like Joe Walsh and John Mayer, Sheryl Crow, just these incredible musicians and singers. And I got to actually sing with Vince Gill and Vince's band. They backed me up. And just the coolest thing is that we have maintained a friendship and have maintained and kept in contact and may actually get to work on some other projects together. Eric's expressed some interest on working on some other projects. And it just is proof again that God can do anything and God can bring anybody, two people from two totally different worlds together. It's just amazing.
It's amazing. We were talking just a minute ago on a little commercial break, kidding, could we borrow some money from you? Because you're the only one that has a real job. And you work at a power plant in Alabama.
I do.
And you have for years and years. And you sing from time to time. But what I love is that there are things that we do in our life where, you know, you work hard. I've paid my dues, and I found my opportunity, and I took hold of that opportunity. Those things happen from time to time for us. And then there are other things, the better things, which is, I didn't do that.
Yeah.
Right.
I didn't do that. And that's what I love about this moment is when you least expect it, and sometimes we do find ourselves questioning, thinking, am I making any difference? I might love this song or this album or this message, and I don't know if anybody's even hearing it out there. You know, it's hard to tell. And when you get a call like that, you realize that one of the most famous rock stars in the world is listening to YouTube. He's on YouTube listening to gospel songs, and he's listening to you sing a song you guys made together. Yeah. Yeah. And then he picks up the phone and calls you and invites you to be part of his big event. I just think it's the power of the internet, but it's really more, it's the power of the lighthouse. I mean, right. It really is. You, right. You've got a light that was shining, and somehow it made its way all the way across the sea to him, mm-hmm. and you were part of that. And I liked being in the audience. You guys were rehearsing, and it is. It's literally most of the Eagles are all there, and Bradley Walker. Yeah. Which was pretty darn cool. Well,
it's just crazy because it makes you realize God has bigger plans. And God can do things and will do things that are so far beyond anything we can imagine mm-hmm. if we'll just let Him. That's the key, is just letting Him, you know. And so I'm just so thankful to get opportunities like that. And I know that it's not anything that I could ever do. It's all the good Lord. It's all His, part of His plan.
I wanted to pay tribute to the Statlers. And you know, I felt like the best way to do that was record one of their songs. And then Jimmy was like, yeah, that would be great to do that.
Class of 57 is such a well-written song. It kind of encompasses the Statler Brothers and what they were about. They were nostalgic and historic, and the magical thing about this song was that each person in that song was actually the person that did what they said they did in it, and it was real.
In their graduating class.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
That's amazing.
In their lives.
And it was
in
like Harold's 50, he was 55 and graduated, but the 55 wouldn't work, so they just used 57. So, you know, as you know, in songwriting, you have to kind of make things work in a way for the song itself. But the magical part was that every person was real. And when it gets to the part where things get complicated when you get past 18, boy,
how true is that?
I mean, it just knocked me back. I mean, because it's true.
Well, I love the idea that, you know, looking back, those people that you went to school with, who wrote in your yearbook or probably knew you at that time and knew you were dreaming about things like this, that they get to look at your life now, and they've got to be mighty proud of you and what you've done and where your music has taken you. You guys have really done amazing things. I love that.
Thank you so much.
We've all got a page in this particular song, Class of 57. Yes, we're all still writing our page. I love how much fun you guys all have together.
We do.
It shows in your rapport with each other, but it also shows in the music. You know, you guys have a good time in the songs that you're doing. And then, boy, you can bear down too. Some of the painful things are, you guys really do them well too.
Thank you.
This song is a really special song to me in my life. Because like you all, you know, I've lost deeply and grieved deeply for someone. And I love the power of music, the way that it can heal. It can help you. You know, you're not going to get better, but you can get through it. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? It can make you, somehow country music has a way of like hurting with you. Mm-hmm. Like Vince Gill, when he did this song, I'm just listening on the radio, and I think it was for his brother, right? Mm-hmm. Originally?
Yep. Yeah.
Go Rest High. And you could feel his pain. Mm-hmm. And it wasn't mine. It was also for Keith mm-hmm. Whitley at the time.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
You could feel his pain, and it was tangible. And then when time comes around and you have your own pain and you still hear him singing that song, he feels strangely like he is singing it for you. and your loss. And that's what this song feels like to me, is that the whole world, you know, we're not going to go through life without feeling some pain and some loss, without losing some loved ones. But music can help us get through it. And this song just is a tangible way of letting someone go.
Yeah.
And I just love the version that you did of this. I found myself thinking, if you had to dedicate this song to someone you lost, to someone in particular, who would that be?
A friend of mine, you're one of my best friends. His name was David Kidd. We were on having fun four-wheeling one day up in Virginia, and his brother, we started together, started playing music together. We played, when we were 13, we got together and put our band together, and his brother's name was Curtis Kidd. I found those guys just down the road from me, and they knew that they could play guitars and they could sing. Put together our first band. And so through the years, we'd always stay in touch, and we played together for quite a few years. We're on this four-wheeling expedition, and one day, and he, right in front of me, was killed on a four-wheeler. And it was the hardest day of my life. But he was like a brother to me, and it's probably the closest thing of like a brother that I've ever lost. And I had to tell his wife and three daughters that he didn't make it that day. And so I think of him when I sing that song.
I would have to say that the person that I would dedicate it to would be my grandfather on my mom's side. He died, I was young when he died. And I still remember stories about him, but the pain that my grandparents went through at being Holocaust survivors. And the peace, you know, my mom was able to pray with my grandfather and my grandmother on their deathbeds. And I think about him more than anybody because of the pain that was inflicted on their lives by nothing that they did other than just being a race, a Jewish race. And for me to think about my grandfather, Oscar Fishman, peaceful now.
Yeah.
You know, he died from kidney failure because of alcohol abuse, because he couldn't handle it.
Wow.
Yeah.
Yeah.
My father.
Your father?
Yeah. He passed away a few years ago. And he taught me, Jimmy, you met him. You got to pick with him.
Yeah.
He taught me so much about.
He's like my dad.
Oh, yeah. He taught me so much about music and life. Just love.
What about you, Bradley?
Well, it'd have to be my granddaddy, J.D. Adams. That's my granddaddy on my mama's side. Hardest working man I've ever known. Toughest man I've ever known. I mean, really, just tough. Tough, but never said a bad word about anybody. Loved everybody, would give you the shirt off his back. The most honest man. He was killed in a freak accident at work. He was still working, 73 years old.
Man.
And we played this, Vince's version of this song at his funeral. And so that had to be, I'd have to send it out to him.
I know if my pretty bride were here, this would be her favorite song. She'd say, thank you. She's not here, so this is my favorite song. Thank you, guys.